kick off our top five stories of the week is the curious case of former journalist turned minister Agnes Nandutu. Many agree that of all the suspects in the Iron Sheet scandal, she is the one to sympathize with the most. After all, she had just joined parliament, just became a minister. But well, as they say, this life, no balance.
Like I have said before, I have been baptized by fire.
We are told that she was supposed to be arrested alongside Minister Amos Lugolobi on Friday last week, but the gods were not sleeping. Somehow, she caught wind of what was to come and disappeared into thin air. All police summons went unanswered. Police spokesperson Fred Enanga even made a statement during the weekly presser expressing frustration at being unable to trace the former journalist.
Summon the Honorable Minister of State for Karamoja Affairs, Honorable Agnes Nandutu, to reappear at CID headquarters and to clarify on certain additional areas of inquiry, but she did not turn up.
But Nandutu was going to do this on her own terms. Come the evening of Tuesday, April 18th, the Karamoja Affairs junior minister surrendered to the Chira Division Police, movie style. The very next day, she was produced at the anti-corruption court, bail denied, her case forwarded to the High Court for trial and remanded. Nandutu will be in Luzira for approximately 2 weeks. What a life. Meanwhile, other suspects, including Finance Minister Matia Kasaija, Ministers Judith Nabakova and Jacob Oboth, sent representatives with iron sheets in tow to the opium stores in Namanve. We continue to follow this absolutely fascinating story. A good thing happened on Twitter this week. Social media users mobilized under the hashtag Kampala Pothole Exhibition and literally went to town. So much that images of potholes around the city caught the attention of the media and policymakers. The mood ranged from frustration to hilarious, with twips photoshopping beachgoers into flooded potholes, boats, and even one depicted a border border launch into space after hitting a pothole. The goal was to make the proverbial above feel uncomfortable enough to do something about it. After some resistance and denial, above began to come around. The best thing from it is that the president ordered the finance ministry to allocate 40 billion shillings to KCCA to fix potholes in Kampala. A tear gas free protest, bravo.
And we have already supported them to be working on the preliminary maintenance. His Excellency the President directed yesterday that we support KCCA fully to ensure that they revamp, they fix the potholes.
Now this is a story that got us asking what on earth is going on at the Ivory Tower. It is also the kind of story that one needed to squint a bit to understand and measure its full impact. This week, officials from Makerere University, led by Vice Chancellor Professor Barnabas Nawangwe, appeared before the Parliamentary Committee on Education to present their ministerial policy statement for financial year 2023-2024. The team asked for 52.9 billion shillings to renovate facilities at the Colleges of Medicine and Veterinary Medicine after the medical board refused to register Makerere graduates. Nawangwe informed the committee that the Vet Board has already suspended registration of Makerere graduates, while the Medical and Dental Practitioners Council has already issued a warning that they will halt registration of medical graduates due to unacceptable training infrastructure and inadequate staffing at respective colleges of medicine.
The Veterinary Board has suspended registration of our graduates because they say the facilities are not adequate enough. Of course, we now have many more students than we had several years back, and the facilities, in their opinion, are not adequate.
The Parish Development Model Program has been packaged as the silver bullet that will lift Ugandans out of poverty. That is why people have taken a great interest in it. So this week, civil society groups made some very interesting statements before Parliament's Committee on Public Service and Local Government. According to the CSOs, ahead of President Museveni's visit to West Nile to spread the gospel on wealth creation, some PDM groups in the region received messages from banks indicating that they had received money on their bank accounts. But guess what? On checking, they found air, hot air. So where did this money go? We hope civil servants are following the Iron Sheet saga as closely as we are.
Some of the abrupt visits by His Excellency the President, some of the community members have been mobilized and sent information that money has reached their accounts. But on further scrutiny, we found that some of them have actually not received from the banks. And this is, of course, concerning. And this is bound to affect the popularity of the strategy, the PDM strategy.
CS Bag implored the committee to put the Ministry of Local Government to task to explain these anomalies so as to enhance transparency and effectiveness of the PDM.
This has led to some reservations in embracing the model. So this is where the initiative is good, but depending on how it's being managed by the leadership down there, it's affecting its popularity. And Chair, therefore, we are tasking the team to clarify on the anomalies, Chair, that we have experienced to enable the promotion and further ownership of the model among the communities.
Our human interest story from Kalangala Island took us on a risky journey to attend school via ferry. Our team followed over 30 pupils from Bugoma village to the MV Sese, the vessel that transports passengers via Lake Victoria. The students commute every day to a school in Masaka district via the water vessel and then walk 8 kilometers to actually get to the school. Their parents would rather not take the children to nearby schools in the district. One of the reasons they give is that the local schools are too expensive, but educators disagree.
Leadership have not done enough to sensitize their parents on why they should pay something at school, on why, because there is nothing like free education anywhere.
Our story also noted that taking children through such tedious journeys out of the island exposes them to a number of risks. And one more for the road. In a suspected land-grabbing case, arsonists burnt down property belonging to an 87-year-old widow. Veronica Akumu is the envy of some locals who seem to be determined to get their hands on 60 acres of land at Agun in Amur district. The fires usually start when she is off to the garden with her grandchildren. 4 huts have been burnt so far. Good thing is the police are on it. The suspects have now gone into hiding. And that brings us to the end of our top 5. We'll see you next week.